So basically, Dana's gonna start talking at like 2 o'clock. So we're like, I don't know, an hour early. So we're just gonna hang out, smoke some weed until that happens, and we'll get that whole thing on camera.
Hello, hello. That's a little better. There we go. I don't even know if I really need a mic or not. Oh, there you go. That's a little better. How's everybody doing? Thanks for having me here in Toronto. This is, I think, stop 15 or 16 or something like that on my Overgrow tour. This is the part where I start to lose track and forget what city I'm in, but I haven't forgotten yet. We've been all across the country. I spent the first part of the tour in BC, going to Victoria and Nanaimo and Kamloops, and we've been in Alberta, and we've landed in St. John's and Halifax and Quebec and Montreal and Ottawa and Peterborough. It's been a busy tour, and everywhere I've been going, we've been giving away thousands and thousands of cannabis seeds. We've been talking to people. Yeah, it's been great. So far we've done, I think, over 2 million seeds now, getting close to 2.5 million seeds this year. We're getting at least 100 new orders every day from people across the country looking for more seeds. And I think we're on target to hit 5 million total by April 20th. All the ones we have left, we're going to send in packages to all the 420 rallies across the country. And so it's very exciting, and people's response is wonderful, wanting to get these seeds and get out in their towns and plant everywhere. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going to talk a bit about this afternoon, I guess. It's not tonight yet, is it? I'm going to talk about the hidden history of cannabis in Canada and tell you some stories and anecdotes from the last 400 years, and I think when I finish my talk, you might agree with me that the leaf on our flag should really be a cannabis leaf, because this plant is so much more deeply entwined in our culture, our society, and our economy than the maple tree has ever been. And the story of cannabis in Canada begins. No heckling me, Mark. So you're going to be trouble.
But just so you know, maple syrup is also a very controlled substance.
It is. They have huge. The mafia stole a bunch of the maple syrup reserves a few years ago out of that. But anyways, you're going to get me sidetracked. So the story of cannabis in Canada begins in 1606 when a man named Louis Hébert planted the first cannabis plants in Canada. He was an apothecary and a herbalist and a very early colonist and a good friend of Samuel de Champlain, and he would have known about the many different uses of cannabis medicinally, nutritionally, and industrially. But at this time in the 1600s and 1700s, almost all the cannabis being grown in Europe was being grown for its fiber. So they could use those fibers to make the ropes and sails to keep the world's navies afloat. And most of that cannabis was being grown in Russia, because Russia had the landmass and the large quantity of poor peasants willing to do the backbreaking labor that it took to prepare those fibers for use. They had to separate the inner pulpy mass from the long, strong fibers in the stalk, and that was a backbreaking and time-consuming effort. And the European powers were trying to find ways to break their dependence upon Russian hemp, and so when they discovered the New World, and they were all over here growing hemp in Chile and South America, and France was growing cannabis in Quebec, and they were desperate to push the colonists to grow more cannabis. The government would subsidize and try to pressure the colonists to grow more, but the colonists weren't really into growing cannabis at this time, because it was such a difficult crop to process, and because a cash crop like cannabis was much less useful in a colony where there wasn't a lot to buy. They wanted to grow food crops so they could eat and survive. So one of the early administrators, a man named Jean Talon, he took a strange method to encourage more cannabis cultivation. He went all around everywhere in Quebec and he seized all of the thread out of their homes and out of the shops. And he would not return any of this thread to anybody unless they would trade it to him for cannabis hemp to push them to grow more cannabis. A few decades later, another administrator tried for several years to buy a boatload of African slaves to get them to come and work on the hemp fields, but he was unsuccessful. They couldn't raise enough money and the boats kept getting diverted to other areas. But he also tried to subsidize and promote cannabis as much as possible. And when the British took over in the 1700s, they also encouraged great cannabis cultivation. It was of such strategic importance that it was a key factor in the Napoleonic Wars and what spilled over into Canada as the War of 1812. When Napoleon was rising to power in France, and England was putting embargoes against European trade, and Napoleon responded by putting embargoes on trade with the United Kingdom, and he included in that a treaty with Russia to stop Russia from selling their cannabis fiber to England. He hoped that this way, within a year or two, the British Navy would be grounded, because they had to replace all those sails pretty much every 12 months. And that lasted for a few years. During that time, England would actually capture American trading ships and force them to go to Russia and buy the cannabis hemp for them, or make deals with them in some way. But eventually, after a few years, Russia decided to back out of that treaty because it was too important for their economy to stop selling cannabis to the British. So they started that up again. Napoleon responded by invading Russia in his disastrous winter invasion that destroyed his army. And so that just shows the key importance of cannabis at this time and how it played such a major role in world affairs. By the mid-1800s, cannabis had finally become widespread across Canada. Enough new immigrants had come that there was the labor pool needed. The technology had advanced somewhat, and there were mills, cannabis mills, operating in every province of the country, and cannabis was being widely grown from coast to coast. This was really the golden age of cannabis in Canada during the 1800s, because not only was industrial hemp now being grown everywhere, but the use and understanding of medical cannabis was expanding drastically. Between 1850 and 1900, over 100 scientific papers were written in North America discussing and analyzing the medical effects and benefits of cannabis. Canadian medical journals had advertisements for cannabis products on a regular basis. You could buy pre-rolled marijuana cigarettes in Canada at pharmacies from 1850 until the beginnings of cannabis prohibition in the 1930s. But one issue at this time was that people didn't know how cannabis actually worked. The active ingredients of THC and CBD and all the cannabinoids were many decades away from being isolated and discovered. They weren't sure if it was the resin or the oil or how to judge the potency of their extracts. And this made cannabis an unreliable medicine. You could buy a cannabis extract at a pharmacy, and one time you might get no effect at all, and another time it might be too strong, and you might find yourself hallucinating or having an unpleasant experience. Parke Davis, one of the largest pharmaceutical companies, would advertise in Canadian medical journals that you could trust their products for their potency and for the right accuracy when it comes to their measurements. And the reason that you could trust their products, they said, was because although it is true there is no known chemical test for cannabis, Parke Davis would do a biological test that guaranteed that their products were as advertised. What that biological test meant was that they would have hundreds of dogs in a lab, and someone's job would be to give these dogs standardized doses of different cannabis extracts, and then take notes and write down how long it took for that dog's tongue to fall out of its mouth, how long for their legs to buckle, how long for the dog to finally fall unconscious. This was the height of cannabis testing technology in the 1850s, having these labs full of dogs. And although I'm not a huge fan of animal testing, you've got to be one of the animals being tested on. Probably the dog that gets super high every day is the best gig you're going to get. But regardless, this shows that these products were being widely used, and they were trying to make a serious effort to make sure they were providing a good quality medicine to people. There's an interesting story that was in Canadian medical journals in the 1850s, and it was the story of Canada's first known hashish overdose. Now, we know that a cannabis overdose doesn't mean you risk death. It simply means you've gotten too high and you're not having a very good time anymore. And that's what happened to this one Canadian who was good friends with the doctor. And his doctor ended up writing up this report, and he described his friend as someone who had heard the wonders of the cannabis indica and wanted to try them for himself. And he had done so several times, but he had had no effect. He hadn't been able to get high. And he was starting to say, oh, it has no effect on me. I must be immune to this stuff. So his doctor said, well, why don't you try some of this? And gave him a very strong and potent cannabis extract. And I really think we need more doctors like that today.
But he took the cannabis extract, and maybe it was a little too much for him, because an hour later, he describes his soul leaving his body and flying around the room, and he's alternating between moments of extreme ecstasy and existential dread, and by the end of it, he says, it was a dread experiment that I would never suffer again. But what I think is most interesting about this is that cannabis medicines were widely used and widespread at the time, but the doctor describes this as a very rare and unique circumstance. So it seems to me that most Canadians that were using cannabis were not having these kinds of experiences when this hashish overdose is worthy of being written up as something different and unique. We fast forward a few decades to the late 1800s and 1895. There was an amazing lecture given by the head of the Nova Scotia Medical Association. And this lecture was reprinted in its entirety in their journal, and I've read it, and it sounds like it could have been made a few months ago. In this lecture, he talks about the medicinal value of cannabis by smoking, eating, and even topical ointments and salves. He discusses the wide range of medical benefits that cannabis has, and he also talks about recreational and social use as well. He talks about doctor friends of his that are taking enormous doses of cannabis medicines to show their patients how safe it is. And he says these doctors would describe experiences, like after taking their cannabis extracts, they would notice later that the second hand on their watch seemed to start taking an awfully long time to go around the dial, or the wheels on their carriage would seem to be going very slowly, even though they were traveling at quite a rapid pace. He also even talks about cannabis to improve your sex life, and says that men who use cannabis can last longer and have better orgasms. He doesn't get into woman's sexuality so much, it's still 1895, but I think the point is that all the things he talks about for cannabis use are all the same things that we use it for now, for medical, for social, for recreational, for spiritual and sexual purposes. All those things, Canadians were using cannabis in a widespread and normalized way over 100 years ago. So how did we get from that time, the golden age of cannabis in Canada, to this 100 years of prohibition and drug war that we've now been living through? Well, the war on cannabis and the war on drugs in Canada really began with a war on opium. And the war on opium was really a war on Chinese people. The Chinese men that had come to Canada for a few decades to work on the railways, to work in the gold mines, they were lured here and promised great wealth and riches, but when they arrived, they were worked very hard and often to death. And when those jobs were done, there was a large pool of single Chinese men living in cities across the country, concentrated in Vancouver and Montreal and a few other cities, and these men would often be willing to work for less than the white workers would work for. Partly because they had no families to support locally, and there was no way for them to send money back home like there is now, so their needs would have been less. And these Chinese men, by and large, preferred to smoke opium over drinking alcohol. Now that was actually a rational choice, because they would have been working back-breaking, laborious jobs, and opium is an incredible pain reliever. And also, there was a very common and deadly disease at this time called dysentery. Dysentery is basically diarrhea so severe that it kills you, and it was widespread at this time. And the one side effect of using opium is constipation, so it acts as a folk medicine and a treatment against dysentery. So it would have made a lot of sense to want to smoke opium back then. And another reason the Chinese were using opium is because a few decades earlier, England had found themselves addicted to a Chinese drug that we call tea. And England was spending so much of their money, of their treasury, of silver, to get the Chinese tea that they were going to go bankrupt as a country. They had nothing that the Chinese wanted in return except for cash. And so England, which controlled India, decided to take the opium being grown in India and send that to China to redress the trade imbalance. And China, I think, made a mistake. They prohibited opium and tried to stop the British from bringing it in, which kept prices high and which empowered the British smugglers. And ultimately, England went to war against China to force China to accept English opium. They were called the Opium Wars. There was a few of them over a decade or so. And at the end of that time, England had seized Hong Kong as an opium trading port and had forced the Chinese to accept their opium. So a few decades later, when the Chinese men were coming to Canada to work, they were coming to an essentially British country and saw no harm in bringing opium with them as part of their experience. But after these jobs were done and There was a lot of single men living here, willing to work for lower wages. There was a lot of animosity between the white community, specifically the white labor groups that saw these Chinese as an attack on their ability to find employment. And so there was many large riots and conflicts, especially in Vancouver. One of those was in 1908. There was a huge gathering downtown in Hastings in Maine in Vancouver, and speeches were made and slogans were yelled. And these were groups with names like the Anti-Asiatic League or the Anti-Chinese League. They were not subtle about their viewpoints or their intentions. And in 1908 specifically, they gathered and they stormed into Chinatown and they beat up people and smashed windows and wrecked buildings and caused a lot of damage to that area. So the federal government decided to make reparations to the Chinese community, and they sent someone over to Vancouver to decide who should get what and how to pay back this community for the damage that had been done. And the man they sent over was named William Lyon Mackenzie King. At this time, he was a deputy minister of labor, but he later became prime minister of Canada and was most well known for using Ouija board to talk to his dead dog and his dead mother and get political advice from them. Well, it seems that his dead dog and his dead mother did not like cannabis or opium, because when he became prime minister, he oversaw the creation of the war on drugs in Canada. And when he was in Vancouver to make those reparations, he saw there was many opium dens that had also been damaged and were also seeking compensation. And on his own initiative, he wrote a report calling for the prohibition of opium. And within a year, this law had been passed, introduced by the Minister of Labor, showing that it was really about eliminating a group from the labor pool. And that was the exact result this law had. Once the first prohibition of opium was passed, in some parts of Canada, up to 2% of the Chinese population was deported within 1 year. Thousands of Chinese men were arrested and imprisoned in raid opium dens on a regular basis. Like now, the police would claim they were only really going after the big dealers and sellers, but in practice, over 90% of their arrests and convictions were against users only. And this law, this first law, didn't actually ban opium in its entirety. It allowed it in tinctures and beverages and extracts the way white people would typically use it. It only banned smoking opium, which was the way it was commonly used by the Chinese. And we saw during this time, in the early 1900s and through the 1920s, an increasing racial and drug panic among white Canadians. This very real fear, not based on reality, but a real fear nevertheless, that the Chinese and then the black communities were looking to dominate the white race and to take control of Canada by using opium and other drugs. And these fears were spread in books like The Black Candle, written by Emily Murphy, who wrote under the patriotic pen name Janie Canuck. And her book was serialized in Maclean's magazine. It was a best-selling book, and in there she describes that, and under her words, the Chinese people don't even use opium. They are only bringing it to Canada so they can addict us, and especially our white woman. That's what they want to control, that's what they want to get, and they want to take over our country. There was a popular novel at this time called The Writing on the Wall, about a regular middle-class pair of bureaucrats in Vancouver who become opium addicts, and they ultimately help their Chinese overlords to subvert Canadian democracy, and by the end of the book, China controls Canada and our whole country is addicted to opium. This was a best-selling novel. And these fears began to spread to marijuana as well. In The Black Candle, Emily Murphy writes or quotes the chief of police of Los Angeles talking about marijuana and gives them a whole chapter. In that chapter, he describes how cannabis causes violence and destruction, how marijuana users lose all self-control and all sense of right and wrong, and they will kill and maim and rape without any hesitation. Most Canadians did not realize that marijuana was the same thing as cannabis or hemp, these plants that they were using widely and still cultivating widely, although at this time, cannabis had started to fall out of favor in Canada as an industrial crop. In the very late 1800s and early 1900s, there was the invention of the steam engine and the cotton ginny. And these two technologies replaced a lot of the uses for cannabis. The steam engine meant that boats didn't need all those big sails anymore. And the cotton gin meant that cotton could be processed and manufactured much more cheaply and easily than hemp could. But in the early 1920s, in the late 1920s and early 30s, we were beginning to see a resurgence of the cannabis and the possibility that the cannabis was going to make a big comeback. This is because a new technology had been invented called the decorticator. This new machine, which was actually perfected in Canada, was a technology that would allow the hemp plant to be processed much more easily, because that inner pulpy core could be sucked out by this tractor and not have to have all that labor involved. And in fact, that new technology that was coming on board was getting a lot of attention, because these fibers can now be extracted very easily, but at the same time, the pulp that was being extracted, that used to be a waste product, could now be kept and could be used to make anything that you wanted, to make out of plastics. You could now make out of that waste product as well, those pulpy herds. And this was so exciting that magazines were writing articles about it, and the most famous was Popular Mechanics, which in 1938 had a story about a new billion-dollar crop. And that's $1 billion in 1930s money. We're talking trillions of dollars by modern accounting. And that value is going to be there, because this pulp could be used to make anything that you currently use to petroleum to make, from cellophane to dynamite and everything in between. But the same year that law was passed, in 1938, we saw the actual prohibition of cannabis in Canada begin. And so the law against cannabis was passed, and the same year this plant was about to make this big comeback, we saw the RCMP begin the war on cannabis in Canada in earnest. And they began that war first by going to farmers that were growing hemp and burning the crops to the ground. This was well documented in newspaper articles at the time, and the farmers would say they had no idea they'd been growing this deadly narcotic crop in their field. They thought they were just growing a crop for seed or fiber, or maybe just a windbreak. But after they had burned the cannabis hemp to the ground, the police then went to the birdseed manufacturers, and they told them, you've got to get those hemp seeds out of your birdseed, or we're going to arrest you. And they raided some of the birdseed manufacturers, because hemp seed is the world's number one best birdseed, and they wanted to get that out of there. The third step that the police did to launch cannabis prohibition in Canada was to raid pharmacies and arrest medical marijuana users. In fact, the first Canadian that we have a record for being arrested for cannabis possession is a man by the name of Harry Forbes, who was arrested in Vancouver for possession of some of those pre-rolled marijuana cigarettes I was telling you about. And he told the judge that he had bought them at a pharmacy to treat his hay fever. The judge said that's a deadly narcotic drug and gave him 6 months of hard labor. And the first Canadian we have a record for of being arrested for trafficking in marijuana was a pharmacist, also in Vancouver. And he told the judge that he had never considered cannabis to have any narcotic content. He was also charged and convicted for trafficking. So that's how the war on cannabis in Canada began. It began with the police burning down hemp fields, raiding birdseed manufacturers, shutting down dispensaries and pharmacies, and arresting medical marijuana patients. And this began a dark time, a challenging time for the cannabis culture. There was a slight rebirth during World War II for 2 years, when the federal government re-legalized cultivation of industrial hemp to get those fibers for the war effort. And not only in Canada, but in America as well, the U.S. government legalized cannabis cultivation for the war effort, and they actually made a film, a little 10-minute propaganda film called Hemp for Victory, to encourage American farmers to grow more cannabis for the war effort. Even the Nazis recognized the strategic value of cannabis during World War II, and they put out what was called the Humorous Hemp Primer, with rhyming couplets explaining how to grow hemp for the fatherland, and a male and female cannabis plant looking very Aryan and rosy-cheeked. And when World War II was done, Prohibition was relaunched again, cannabis cultivation was done, and that was it for many decades to come. But one thing that did happen during World War II is that many young men went overseas to France and Africa, and they experienced hashish and cannabis and brought their knowledge of this plant back home with them to the colleges and campuses around the country. And they planted the seeds that eventually blossomed into the Beat Generation, which then became the Yippies and the Hippies, and cannabis use and cannabis culture expanded in Canada during the late 1940s and during the 50s quite a bit. So much so that by the end of the 50s, the federal government decided to launch a commission into cannabis. It was the Canada Senate had a study and an analysis of cannabis, but the only people they listened to were police and prohibitionists, and the police said you can't trust cannabis users or opium users, they're all liars and addicts and thieves and terrible people. So the Senate ended up recommending that Canada's cannabis laws become even more strict. And so at this time, late 1950s, they passed laws to make it so that simple possession of cannabis was a 6-month mandatory minimum sentence, and that importing or cultivation of any quantity of cannabis became a mandatory 7-year minimum jail sentence. That made those crimes the most severe in the criminal code, except for first-degree murder and treason. So treason, first-degree murder, growing a marijuana plant. That was the law in the late 1950s and early 60s. And yet, at this time, it was the time of the greatest growth of the cannabis culture and cannabis use in Canadian history. Cannabis use and cannabis arrests both skyrocketed from a handful of arrests every year to a few hundred to a few thousand to by the end of the 60s when there was tens of thousands of arrests every year for simple possession of cannabis. So the federal government under Trudeau, or Pierre Trudeau, decided to launch another commission in 1971, which was the Ledain Commission. The Ledain Commission did a lot more detailed scientific analysis and actually talked to cannabis users as well as to scientists and other researchers, and they recommended that cannabis use be decriminalized with no penalties at all for possession, and to also eliminate the penalties for personal cultivation of cannabis. And they also recommended that some more research be done before we could finally move to full legalization. That came out the year I was born, 1971. None of its recommendations were followed at all, and prohibition continued. Although at this time, there was actually some interesting research being done into cannabis on many fronts in Canada. There was a large study that was commissioned by the federal government, which looked into all aspects of cannabis use. They interviewed users and dealers and growers and smugglers. They analyzed distribution networks. They did IQ studies. They did driving studies. They did every kind of analysis. They talked to all kinds of people, and they came up with a lot of interesting information. One of the studies that they did, which I find very interesting, was they wanted to study the effects of cannabis use on motivation. So they got a bunch of young women together, and they said, you have the opportunity to make some pretty good money. If you can knit colorful scarves for a month, we'll pay you some pretty decent money for every scarf that you knit. But the deal is, you've got to do it in this hospital wing, and every day we're going to make you smoke increasingly potent joints the size of your pinky finger. And that's how we're going to see how this affects you or not. And so these women were enrolled in this program, and they would describe how they'd be there smoking their joint, and then be a nurse saying, you've got to smoke more of that before you're allowed to get to work. Make sure you finish that all the way down to the roach. And then at the end of this time, these studies were done, and then before the research could be finally analyzed and the results could be compiled and put together, the federal government cut off the funding, and almost none of this research was completed. The head researcher was so disgusted, he quit, went and joined Normal Canada. To my understanding, a lot of this stuff is still on microfiche somewhere in Ottawa. But when they say we need more research, well, they did that 45 years ago, or 46 years ago, and it was it's all on microfiche somewhere in Ottawa.
For sure.
So that's pretty disgusting, really. But there was some other research being done as well. I don't normally talk about this during my talks too much, but there was a man named Ernie Small who was growing quite a large quantity of cannabis for the federal government in Ottawa, at the Central Experimental Farm in Ottawa. It's on a street called Ash Lane, and when he was there, they would call it Hash Lane. And he was growing dozens of different strains of cannabis for the federal government to study. He would grow plants that were 20 feet tall sometimes. I've seen pictures of him out there with an axe cutting some of these things down. And he wrote a book called The Species Problem in Cannabis, trying to decide how cannabis should be categorized, what the different species are, and how to arrange the taxonomy of this plant. And he found that there are it's a continuum of cannabis, from varieties that have different cannabis profiles to different heights. There's not distinct boundaries, but a continuum of different varieties. And he found that when it comes to what we call hemp, the high CBD varieties, what we call marijuana, the high THC varieties, there was no distinct cutoff point between these two things. But he decided through his research to cut what he called an arbitrary line at 0.3% THC between hemp and marijuana. And that arbitrary decision by Ernest Small has become the standard for the legal definition of what hemp is in Canada. But that was something that was really just based on him drawing a line somewhere on a graph and deciding that was the difference between hemp and marijuana. In reality, it's all a big continuum. So we have the 1970s. Everybody in Canada thought legalization was coming any day now. There was groups like Normal Canada and other activist groups were forming. In the U.S., many American states were voting to decriminalize cannabis possession. Jimmy Carter was saying that he thought cannabis should be decriminalized. Justin Trudeau and Joe Clark were both saying they were promising to change the marijuana laws and decriminalize in some way. Normal Canada even held a premature victory party to celebrate the impending legalization, but boy, were they a bit too early, hey? It's 45 years later and we're not here yet. But all these, everybody was expecting it to happen. The government was even preparing in some ways for legalization, but then we saw the election of Ronald Reagan in the U.S. in 1980, and his wife Nancy Reagan, who relaunched the war on drugs with the Just Say No campaign. And they made the war on drugs a very real war that involved troops going overseas to fight and kill people to keep cannabis and other plant medicines out of their country. And in Canada, we saw the election of Brian Mulroney, who relaunched the war on drugs in Canada. He was the first prime minister to use that phrase, the war on drugs. And he passed one of the strictest censorship laws in the world against cannabis and the Canadian cannabis culture. Section 462.2 of the Criminal Code, which prohibits all instruments and literature for illicit drug use. And this word literature is defined so broadly as to include Cheech and Chong movies, High Times magazine, medical advice about the use of cannabis, or instructions on how to grow cannabis. This law saw head shops across Canada being shut down. The RCMP later reported that they had shut down hundreds of head shops on Yonge Street in Toronto alone. Thousands of shops across Canada otherwise closed down or changed their stock and merchandise to avoid punishment under these laws. And it was a dark time for the cannabis users and the cannabis culture in the late 1980s. I know, I tried to buy a bong then and you could not do it very easily at all. You had to go to the right part of town and talk to the right person, and they might have some kind of plastic or brass pipe under the counter, but it was not easy to get a pipe back then. And I remember way too many times smoking out of a pop can or a beer can with some holes punched in it, and I don't ever want to have to do that again. But we saw in the early 1990s and the mid-1990s the rebirth of the Canadian marijuana movement, and what I really see is the launch of the civil disobedience business aspect of the Canadian cannabis movement that has really taken us to where we are today. And that started in mid-1990s with Marc Emery and others opening bong shops. Marc opened Hemp BC in Vancouver and began selling bongs and pipes and encouraging other Canadians to open stores and wholesaling to them. And we saw what was happening then was similar to what's happening now with dispensaries, although on a smaller scale, but stores were opening all across the country. Sometimes they would get raided, they would often reopen. People would sometimes lose their savings or see their business wiped out. Some Canadians went to jail for the weekend or sometimes for a week or two if they violated their bail related to their bongs. But by and large, in that time, we won the war on the bongs. There's still places in Canada where people get arrested for selling bongs and pipes. These laws are still on the books. And like they did in the 90s, the police often don't lay charges for these bong raids. They just come in and take all your stuff, which they commonly do on dispensary raids now also. I remember seeing them packing up huge boxes full of glass pipes and beautifully created glass bongs and works of art and throwing them in the back of the police truck where they would shatter and destroy them. So they would often not bother laying charges, because when you go to court for these kind of things, the Canadian judges do not treat these very seriously and often give people fines or community services or discharges. And the police go, wait a minute, we spent $100,000 on those bong raids and they're getting a $500 fine in community service. And so By and large, over time, through persistence and civil disobedience, the war on bonds has been mostly over in most parts of the country. But there are still small towns where they get raided. I know a guy in Kirkland Lake that had their bong shop shut down a couple of years ago. Other small towns have had raids. And strangely, Winnipeg, every 2 years or so, they raid all their bong shops and take all their stuff. I don't know why Winnipeg, but it's just the last outpost of big city bong madness in Canada. But after bongs, we saw the beginning of the seed bank movement, also pushed by Marc Emery, who was selling seeds to other Canadians and then across the border to Americans, which netted him 4 years in an American prison. But by and large now, seeds are sold very openly and widely, certainly to other Canadians. There's hundreds and hundreds of seed outlets in Canada that sell seeds, and I think I'm one of the very few Canadians who have been charged with any kind of seed-related offense in the last 5 to 10 years or so, and I really had to go out of my way and on a national tour to get them to arrest me for seeds. So that's pretty rare these days as well. And with after the seeds, we saw the evolution of our cannabis events and rallies that started out with just a few people gathering together nervously on a lawn or a park or in front of a legislature somewhere. And these events have grown and grown every year till now we have tens or hundreds of thousands of Canadians gathering in cities and towns all across the country to celebrate cannabis, protest prohibition, and use cannabis openly. And so we've, I think, accomplished a lot. And now we have the dispensary movement. And some of our oldest dispensaries in Canada are almost over 20 years old, but the vast majority have opened in the last few years. And although there's certainly been raids and struggles and charges, it's true that the vast majority of dispensaries in Canada have never been raided, and the majority of those that have been raided have reopened successfully. There's definitely been a lot that have opened and shut down, or those that have been raided and couldn't take it and shut down, but I think that by and large, the dispensary movement is winning all across the country. When I opened my dispensary in 2008, we were the third one in Vancouver. Now it's 9 years later, there's 100 or more in Vancouver, there's hundreds more across the country, and I think this movement has been remarkably successful. But one of the last things that we can't do openly when it comes to cannabis is to grow this plant and to grow it openly and freely. And I think that's why I'm out here giving away these seeds and encouraging Canadians to get involved and to plant these seeds in their gardens or in public places and traffic circles, in front of police stations, in front of City Hall. Anywhere where there's a happy little patch of dirt that needs some greenery, I want you to plant some of these cannabis seeds, because I want to live in a Canada when I walk down the street and I see a patch of cannabis plants growing in somebody's front yard. I can admire them for their beauty, but it's not a big deal. I don't need to freak out and go, oh my goodness, there's cannabis. Has anybody else seen this? Oh, what's going to happen? I want it to be that I've seen dozens of other plants and dozens of other cannabis gardens that day as I walk around my neighborhood. That's the kind of country that I want to live in. I don't think that we get to legalization by waiting for our politicians to act or by waiting for Trudeau to grant us our freedom. We get to legalization by taking our freedom and by standing up as Canadians all at once and rooms like this all across the country and in cities and towns everywhere. If Canadians stand up, if we normalize the cultivation of cannabis, if we continue on this crusade to break these laws openly and transparently, then we will get the legalization we want, and it won't matter what the politicians do or say, because we'll make it happen on the ground every day. So I want you to imagine a better future with me. I want you to imagine a future where the war on cannabis is over, where cannabis is normalized and accepted, and you're a grandparent or a grandmother or a grandfather, and you're there at home with your grandchild, and you're starting your day, you've had a bowl of cannabis, and you had a bowl of cannabis cereal as well, and your grandchild is there studying their history book, cramming for an exam coming up that morning as they get ready to go to school. And your grandchild turns to you and they say, Grandma, Granddad, I'm reading in my history book here, and there's a chapter on the history of cannabis in Canada. And it says here that cannabis was illegal in Canada for like 100 years. and that people would be arrested and go to jail, and it was a huge deal, and the government would spend billions of dollars to prohibit cannabis and punish people for its use. But I don't understand, how can that be? How can that be? Because I know that the book that I'm reading is printed on cannabis hemp paper. I know that the clothes that I'm wearing are cannabis hemp fibers. I know that you use cannabis medicines, and I know that we have a patch of cannabis growing in the backyard, and those plants are so beautiful, and I love helping you tend to them and take care of them. And I know that the bus that takes me to school runs on cannabis biodiesel, and that it's made out of cannabis fiberglass and cannabis plastics. And I know that the school that I learn in is built out of hempcrete and uses cannabis insulation. And so with all these ways that this plant is in our lives, I don't understand how it could have been illegal for so long. That just seems weird to me. And I want you to be able to say that, yeah, that's true. It was a very dark time. And when I grew up, you couldn't use cannabis openly, or you would be risking being punished or being arrested. And even people that needed cannabis for medical use had to hide or to pretend to be ashamed of their use and try to avoid punishment. And it was very expensive and difficult to get. And it was very challenging. And maybe myself or someone else in our family was arrested or charged or even jailed just because they liked to grow cannabis or because they wanted to make it available to other Canadians. But I also want you to be able to say something else. I want you to be able to say, but you know what? I did something. I got involved to change those laws. Whether it was opening a dispensary or a vapor lounge or a bong shop, or whether it was planting those seeds that Dana brought to town and making sure they grew in some great places, or whether it was writing a letter to the editor every couple of days, or whether it was just donating a few dollars to a legalization organization, or whether it was just spending some time every day talking to somebody who didn't understand the benefits of cannabis and explaining to them why cannabis is good and why prohibition is wrong. But whatever it is, I did something every day. I gave of myself, I sacrificed in some small way. And I did that so that you, the future generation, would never have to know what it is to be afraid or risk arrest for what herbal medicine you use, or to be afraid of being charged or imprisoned for what plants you choose to grow in your garden. That is the legacy that I want to leave to my kids and grandkids. I don't want to pass down to them the war on cannabis and the war on drugs the way it has been passed down to us. We have a unique opportunity now in Canada to make this change happen by getting together, by planting these seeds, by getting involved, by pushing it over the top so we can truly end cannabis prohibition in Canada. So I hope that you will join me in planting these seeds around your community, because when we get together and we plant the seeds of cannabis, together we can reap a harvest of freedom. Thank you very much for hearing my talk. And